Okay, now we're gonna discuss protein, so it's sort of in the second last stretch of our lecture. We're gonna discuss proteins and then we're gonna touch on vitamins and how they relate to bioenergetics. Okay, so what is a protein? Just like lipids and carbohydrates, proteins mostly consist of carbon chains, carbon rings with oxygen and hydrogen. But unlike lipids and carbohydrates, proteins also contain nitrogen. It will also contain sulfur, phosphorus, cobalt, and iron. Our most famous sort of iron-containing protein, you could say, is hemoglobin, which is protein with iron in it. And then, as mentioned earlier, cytochromes in our electron transport chain have an iron core. And protein molecules are made up of individual amino acids. So then what is an amino acid? Well, amino acids are a group of 20 different molecules, and all of these amino acids have two specific properties which make them amino acids. First of all, the amine group, which is NH2, which is NH2 ion at the one end, and on another end you'll have a carboxylic acid group, which is an ion of COOH. And then the rest of the molecule will be a side chain. And this side chain is actually what determines the properties of the amino acid. Okay, so sometimes things are a bit easier to explain in pictures. So here's a picture of a generic sort of amino acid. Here is our NH2 group, our amine group. It's linked onto a carbon. On the other side, we have a carboxyl group, COOH, and if you have this on your molecule, it will be an amino acid. And attached to the carbon over here will be what's called the side chain. So let's take our simplest sort of protein molecule, or amino acid, sorry, alanine. We have a carboxylic acid over there, our amine here, and our side chain consists of just one extra carbon with its hydrogens. And if we just plop in one extra carbon of the hydrogens, we get alanine. And then we can plop in extra carbons and extra components to make it on more complicated amino acids. now if we add, if we combine two amino acids together, we're going to have something called a peptide. And in order to make a peptide, we're going to have to remove one of the carboxyl groups. So we're going to end up having a molecule with two amine groups, but only one carboxyl group. For example, if we had to take and combine just two amino acids, and if we combine two amino acids, we'd refer to that as a dipeptide. If we're going to take three amino acids, we're going to cut off the two carboxyl groups and combine them. We're going to end up with three amine groups and just one carboxyl group. That will make a tripeptide, and so on and so forth. And if we combine amino acids continuously on and on and on, we're going to have something called a polypeptide. If we combine more than 100 amino acids, we have what we call a protein. And there are over 50,000 protein-type molecules in the human body. So that's 50,000 different combinations of amino acids, or more, where there's more than 100 amino acids all combined together. Okay, so our amino acids are further subdivided into non-essential and essential amino acids. In humans, there are 8 amino acids which cannot be synthesized. That's 9 in our younger specimens. Or they can be synthesized, but not at a sufficient rate fast enough to compensate for metabolic needs. So these amino acids we have to take orally, and they're referred to as essential amino acids, in the sense that they must be in our diet, present to some extent in our diets, in order for us to be healthy. The rest are considered non-essential amino acids. Most human beings have enough enzymes available to synthesize these amino acids. So it's important to get enough protein in the diet to be able to synthesize our non-essential amino acids. But we can convert any amino acid that we get from our diet into our amino acids required for metabolic processes. Now, our essential amino acids are mostly made in plants, and plants combine nitrogen, carbon, oxygen, and hydrogen in order to make them. And in the human diet, we typically get our essential amino acids from animal sources, but animals in and of themselves get them from plants in the first place. Now, lack of any one of these essential amino acids may prevent the synthesis of other amino acid side chains. Some of our non-essential amino acids are actually made from essential amino acids in the first place. So if you have a deficiency in one essential amino acid, you may have a deficiency then of non-essential amino acids as well on top of that. So entire groups of protein molecules may fail to arise due to the lack of one essential amino acid. Okay, so the ability to make, to change amino acids and to synthesize proteins is a process called, requires a process called transamination, whereby we convert amino acid from one form into another. And the steps that are followed in this process, while you take your donor molecule, you take the nitrogen from your donor molecule and then put it on the new molecule that you're attempting to synthesize. And you're going to take an amine group from your amino acid and also put onto that molecule. You're going to have an amine group and a nitrogen group, and then you're going to have a protein from the parts that you've scavenged from your donor molecules. On the other hand, if you take a protein or if you take an amino acid and you break it down, it's referred to as oxidative deamination. You're going to take away the amine group. And this amine group more often than not make urea. Urea has to dissolve in water, and then it is excreted via your kidneys. The most abundant amino acid in the body is glutamine, which is unique because it has two amine groups. So if you're trying to make new amino acids or new proteins and you need a donor molecule to take nitrogen, you're not going to go wrong by requesting glutamine as your donor molecule, because then you actually have two nitrogens that you can harvest from the glutamine. So glutamine nutrient functions as a nitrogen transporter and an energy, almost as an energy storage form, because it can easily give off nitrogens to make the amino acids that can be converted into Krebs cycle components. Okay, so let's make some energy from our amino acids and proteins. And so the basic rule of thumb is to make ATP from amino acids, we have to get rid of that amine group. The nitrogen has to be removed from the molecule. So let's talk about how that happens. The most common metabolic pathway to get to our end point of removing that nitrogen is to convert amino acids into glutamate. So we have transaminases in the liver. These are enzymes that convert amino acids into other amino acids. And within the liver mitochondria, we convert our amino acids into glutamate. There are many other metabolic pathways, but this one appears to be the most developed in humans. Glutamate is going to be dehydrogenated through glutamate dehydrogenase. We're going to need a coenzyme to accept the hydrogens, and we're going to end up with alpha-ketoglutarate. We've taken off our nitrogen, our amine, and we've got NADH plus H plus, which in and of itself can go to the electron transport chain. And alpha-ketoglutarate, if you remember diligently, is actually a component of our Krebs cycle. Transaminases can also convert glutamate, combine glutamate with citric acid cycle components to make other proteins, and other alpha-ketoglutarate as a byproduct. So for example, we can take pyruvate and glutamate and combine them together, and we're going to end up with alanine and alpha-ketoglutarate. Or we can take oxalic acetate and glutamate to make aspartate and alpha-ketoglutarate. And these reactions are reversible. So if we have a shortage of oxaloacetate or a shortage of pyruvate, one of the backup systems would be to take our alpha-ketoglutarate and our amino acid and combine the two to get the reverse reaction. Now, most amino acids, when the amine group is removed, will be converted into pyruvate or some other citric acid cycle components. And then these components can be pushed into either the ketogenic or the glucogenic pathways as necessary. Okay, so as you see, when we break down amino acids, we get rid of that amine group. We have that nitrogen group, and that is referred to as nitrogenous waste. So by measuring the amount of nitrogenous waste we produce, we can actually see what is our body's relationship with our proteins and our amino acids. If we break down as much amino acids as we get in, then we have an excretion of nitrogen that is equal to our input of nitrogen, and then we are said to be in nitrogen balance. Now, if we take in a lot of protein, a lot of nitrogen, and when we measure in the urine we actually have very little nitrogen, are taking in more nitrogen than we are excreting. This implies that we are in a state where we are not breaking down proteins for energy, that we are actually saving amino acids and making proteins, which is referred to as an anabolic state, whereby we are making proteins rather than breaking down proteins. And this is referred to as a positive nitrogen balance. Strictly speaking, this is not a balance, because the balance implies equalness, but for the sake of simplicity, it's a positive nitrogen balance is the term that's used. Now, if we end up losing more nitrogen than we are taking in, this implies that we are breaking down proteins, that we are harvesting proteins for energy use, and that's referred to as the negative nitrogen balance. Now, why is this important? Well, endurance athletes can deplete the glycogen from long-standing exertion. The stress of that leads to an elevated cortisol. Cortisol promotes the breakdown of protein for energy synthesis. This protein breakdown occurs mostly in muscle. So, ironically, endurance athletes have a higher need for protein in their diet than your weightlifters, or your sprinters, because they are more likely to push themselves into a negative nitrogen balance, and they need to compensate by taking a lot of protein, otherwise they're going to have muscle wasting. Whereas your resistance athletes, for example, although they might not get stronger unless they have adequate protein content, they are unlikely to get weaker, to enter negative nitrogen balance, if they don't have enough protein intake. So nitrogen balance requires energy balance. In other words, even in the process of adequate protein, if you're taking enough protein, if your total calories are inadequate, if your total ability to generate ATP is inadequate, you're still going to lose nitrogen, you're still going to enter a negative energy balance, and you're still going to lose protein because your muscles are going to be harvested for energy use. Even if your protein and diet is too low, you can maintain your muscle proteins. You can maintain your nitrogen balance by making sure you eat enough calories. Maybe you won't be able to come and become stronger, maybe you won't be able to get bigger muscles. You can at least prevent muscle breakdown by making sure that muscles are not used as an energy source of last resort, by making sure you get calories from elsewhere. The nitrogenous waste is converted into urea and is mostly excreted as this urea by the kidneys. Another byproduct is ammonia, which is why people with hyperammonemia are advised to reduce their protein intake to reduce that nitrogen waste. This nitrogen, this amine group that's been harvested, is converted into urea via the urea cycle. And one of the effects of the urea cycle is that your fumarate releases a byproduct, and fumarate in and of itself is a component of the Krebs cycle. So this breakdown of nitrogen allows us to harvest a little bit of energy from that fumarate. Okay, so amino acids can be converted by transaminases and transaminase processes to pretty much fit into almost anywhere in the Krebs cycle. So, for example, alanine, cysteine, glycine, serine, and threonine can be converted into pyruvate. Isoleucine, leucine, and tryptophan can be converted into acetyl coenzyme A. Phenylalanine, tyrosine, leucine, lysine, tryptophan can be converted into acetyl coenzyme A. From here, it can even go into the ketogenesis. Here's our big guy glutamate, which is converted into alpha-ketoglutarate, and arginine, histidine, glutamine, and proline can be converted into glutamate to begin with. Isoleucine, methionine, and valine can be made into succinyl coenzyme A. Tyrosine and phenylalanine can be made for fumarate. We've already mentioned that the amine group that's harvested from the proteins can in and of itself generate fumarate during the urea cycle. Aspartate and asparagine can be made into oxaloacetate. And to make things even more complicated, a lot of these amino acids can be converted into each other. If you don't have enough aspargine to make oxaloacetate, you can probably make some from one of these amino acids in the first place. Okay, so not only can we harvest energy from amino acids, but we can even make glucose from amino acids, and more often than not, this is done via transformation of amino acids to phosphoenolpyruvate, which, if you remember, was a component of our glycolysis cascade. Phosphoenolpyruvate, more often than not, is abbreviated into PEP. So next time you walk into a PEP store, you walk past a PEP store, think about phosphoenolpyruvate and its role in the glycolytic pathway. Phosphoenolpyruvate, when amino acid is made into phosphoenolpyruvate, can be made from pyruvate. So remember, some amino acids can be converted into pyruvate. Oxaloacetate can be transformed to phosphoenolpyruvate, and malate can be made into phosphoenolpyruvate. So all these things are made from amino acids in the first place. So what we do is we take our amino acids, we convert them into one of these three, and from one of these three we then convert into phosphoenolpyruvate. And unfortunately, this process requires a lot of ATP, a lot of energy. It's an energy expensive process, and it's not a terribly efficient way of making glucose. Now, there are multiple pathways involved, and you can probably win a few Nobel Prizes still elucidating these pathways. The one that we know best is the alanine glucose cycle. So what happens, we have alanine, muscles have enzymes that convert it, convert pyruvate into alanine. Alanine travels into the liver and is reconverted into pyruvate, and pyruvate enters the gluconeogenesis pathway. So if we have excess pyruvate from glycolysis, muscle enzymes will convert that to alanine. The protein travels to the liver and then is broken into pyruvate again, and then makes glucose, which then leaves the liver, enters the bloodstream, enters the muscle, might be even the same muscle fiber from which the alanine came from, and is broken down again into pyruvate. And if the pyruvate is still not taken up into the Krebs cycle, it might be reconverted into alanine, and so on and so forth. Okay, so how do we make PEP? How do we make phosphoenolpyruvate? We're going to need some enzymes, and these enzymes tend to be found on mostly in the liver and the kidney. And if we want to convert pyruvate into phosphoenolpyruvate, we're going to take CO2, we're going to take ATP, we're going to get pyruvate carboxylase, and that's going to convert into oxaloacetate, and we're going to have some ADP and organic phosphate left over. So basically taking the CO2, plonked it on the pyruvate molecule, and we've got the oxaloacetate. Remember, pyruvate is a free carbon molecule. We're adding a carbon to make a four carbon molecule. And we're going to take our GTP, so our phosphoenolpyruvate carboxykinase enzyme that we're going to use now is a G-linked enzyme. It uses GTP preferentially. So we're going to do something to that carboxyl group that's present in the oxaloacetate. So we're going to power this process with GTP, and we're going to end up with phosphoenolpyruvate. We're going to release that CO2, and we're going to have GTP left over. And we're not going to have an inorganic phosphate left over like we had in this process. We're actually taking that phosphate and added it to our molecule to make the phospho part of our phosphoenolpyruvate. And then malate with ATP is converted by malic enzyme directly into phosphoenolpyruvate, releasing CO2, ADP. That inorganic phosphate that was part of the ATP molecule is absorbed into the superstructure of the phosphoenolpyruvate. Okay, so on this slide, I've basically repeat everything I said on the previous slide, but on a chemical formulation. You see with pyruvate, with CO2, with some ATP, and the presence of pyruvate carboxylase makes oxaloacetate. It's a reversible process, and then the oxaloacetate with GTP can be converted by phosphoenolpyruvate carboxylase into phosphoenolpyruvate, releasing CO2, GTP. That phosphate group is integrated into the structure. Remember also, the other way you could go around to make phosphoenolpyruvate, you can actually make it directly from pyruvate using pyruvate kinase, using that reversible reaction in the glycolytic pathway. Then we've got malate, and the presence of ATP and malic enzymes will make phosphoenolpyruvate, and I'm going to release ADP and CO2 as part of as our byproducts. That phosphate group was integrated into phosphoenolpyruvate. Okay, let's talk a bit about the relationship between amino acids and exercise. With exercise, in animal models, there are increases in the levels of your transaminases, which means that you're going to have more efficient amino acid use. So when you take animals and you make them, force them into a sedentary lifestyle, they excrete a lot of nitrogen in their urine. It appears, and the fecal content has greater amino acid concentrations. It appears that they waste amino acids Now, you'd think that once you force an animal to exercise, that you'd actually require more amino acids and more proteins to break down to help get that Krebs cycle going. However, with mild exercise or moderate exercise, your dietary requirements for the amino acids remain exactly the same, but what happens is that you lose less amino acids, so your wastage of amino acids reduces due to the effects of exercise before you reach a point where you actually actively need to take in more amino acids. So with severe or extreme exercise, you might need to take in more amino acids. With moderate exercise, you don't need to take any dietary changes because your wastage of amino acids will reduce. And then leucine is an amino acid which appears to be the preferred amino acid in human muscle tissue for energy use. There are many enzymes of it. There's a well-developed enzyme pathway in human muscle for leucine breakdown, and leucine breakdown products appear to increase with physical exertion. So with physical exertion, that pathway activates and leucine is broken down more. These are my references. I've prepared this lecture from multiple sources, and I hope you found this lecture informative and useful for the completion of your FSG 880 Masters in Sports Medicine.